Hey guys, Jared from the Vinyl Corner, and today we are going to be doing another update video. So before I get into this, I just want to say I'm sorry if there's a lot of like noise. I don't know how sensitive the mic is, but like my neighbors are being pretty loud right now, so I apologize if you can pick up on any of that. And also, I wanted to apologize for the lack of content on here. You know, Connor and I, we are in our 20s. You know, he's going to school. I work a full-time job, technically, too. And so it's really hard for us to find the time to devote to this. It's kind of just like a fun little passion thing we do on the side. So I just wanted to apologize on behalf of us for that. But yeah, the last month has been super busy for me. My life has been in a super transitionary state. And it was also my birthday, so I picked up quite a bit of records here, so I'm going to do this raw like usual and try and blow through them as fast as I can. But yeah, a lot of great stuff, some Grail type stuff in here, so I'm just gonna start with some Discogs purchases and pre-orders. This is most definitely a pre-order. This is Otoboke Beaver's Itacoma Hits. This was a Bandcamp purchase from their Bandcamp page, obviously. And yeah, this is just some extremely awesome hardcore punk, noise rock, riot girl type stuff with some great use of like group vocals. It comes on this beautiful like see-through blue with an orange blob vinyl. This is definitely one of the cooler pieces of wax that I own in my collection. But yeah, this is just a really killer record. Reminds me a lot of Melt Banana, if you guys are into that band at all. They definitely remind me of them, at least to a certain extent. And it comes with a lyric sheet, which is in all Japanese, so that doesn't really help me much, but still cool that they did that regardless. But yeah, one of my favorite albums of the year. I'm pretty sure this was in my top 25 favorite albums of the year so far video. And yeah, this is just absolutely killer stuff. Really happy to own that. Was glad that I grabbed that. I think those were limited to 500 for that specific variant. Next up, my boys at King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard released another album called Infest the Rat's Nest. This is a thrash metal album. I've wanted them to make a metal album for years, and they finally came through and did it, and it's even better than I expected. This might even be in my top 5 favorite King Giz albums, which if you guys know how big of a fan I am of this band, it's pretty impressive. But yeah, it comes with this awesome inner sleeve, and this is the indie record store version, which is on half black, half red vinyl. So yeah, King Giz always been a heavy like psychedelic rock type band, but they've always had that element of heaviness that I've wanted to see them explore more, and they just really nailed the thrash sound on here. It's got a little bit of stoner metal influence, bands like Sleep and stuff like that, and it comes with an enormous poster. I'm not going to unfold it because it's like pretty much as big as I am, but yeah, just great record, really stoked. Obviously King Giz, one of my favorite bands of all time. I buy anything they put out, and I rarely do that with bands just because I like everything they do pretty much. This was also a pre-order for a repress of Lingua Ignota's All Bitches Die. This is a really harsh, industrial, like neoclassical, dark wave type record. This is just really good stuff. I really love this inner sleeve here that's optional, but yeah, Lingua is one of my favorite modern artists. She only has 2 albums so far, but both albums to me are pretty much masterpieces, especially her second album, which she just released this year, which is my favorite album of the year so far, but we'll talk about that in a second. But yeah, just really harsh, chaotic, very heartbreaking. A lot of the lyrical content on here is absolutely brutal to listen to, and Profound Lore finally repressed this, and I was very happy to grab a copy. And speaking of Lingua, we have my favorite album of 2019 so far. This is Caligula by Lingua Ignota. Again, this is a really heavy industrial noise, neoclassical dark wave type album. Her vocal is just on another plane of existence. I mean, she can go from pitch perfect singing to throat singing to screeches in the matter of seconds, and she never loses her pace. This is on a clear vinyl. I love myself some clear vinyl like this. So yeah, As soon as the pre-orders for this went up, I had to grab one. The teaser tracks blew me away, and yeah, this is an absolute masterpiece. This has already turned into like one of my top 10 favorite albums released of my generation. It is not for everyone. It is a very harsh record, very noisy, very chaotic, and again, very brutal. If you read up on her story or into the lyrics, it's very tragic. It's very devastating. But yeah, this is just one of those albums that I think in 5-10 years will be seen as an essential from my generation, and I hope it does become that status, because it absolutely is. This record is just brutal, but it's amazing. It's chaotic, it's beautiful. Her piano playing on certain sections is just absolutely stunning. So yeah. Next pre-order we got up is Prince the Originals Collection. I absolutely adore this collection. Like most people, these are the original versions done by the man himself of the songs that he gave to people to become other singles. I mean, Manic Mondays on here, Jungle Love's on here, Holly Rock, Nothing Compares to You, Glamorous Life. So many classic songs that defined a generation written by this man originally. They come with these really awesome optional picture sleeves, and it's just on black vinyl, so I'm not going to pull them out. But yeah, Prince was just absolutely genius. I can't really say much about the man. These original versions, a lot of the time, I like more than the songs that came out and became big hits. Like, the version of Nothing Compares to You is better than the Sinead O'Connor one, in my opinion. The version of Glamorous Life is eons better than the one that came out, in my opinion. The Manic Monday, it's a completely different vibe, but it's absolutely stunning. So, really happy to get that. Next up, we got Blarf, aka Eric Andre, with Cease and Desist. This is just a fucking whacked out Plunderphonics record. It's kind of one of those love or hate type things, but I absolutely loved it, just on black vinyl, so I'm not gonna pull it out. But yeah, just some really off-kilter weird samples all meshed together to create some absolutely nutty you know, collaborations of sound, including a 12-minute noise track, which is pretty awesome. But yeah, this picture of MJ with his hair on fire from the Pepsi commercial, absolutely iconic. So yeah, was very happy to get that from his Bandcamp. Next up, another top 5 album of the year so far for me. This is Black Midi with Schlagenheim. This is just some absolutely awesome, like, noise rock, kind of no-wavy type stuff, math rocky. It's got a lot of odd time signatures and stuff like that. The artwork all over this is super busy. Like, the more you look at it, the more stuff it reveals to you. So yeah, this is just an absolutely immense record. Just one of the best of the year, absolutely. If you're into your noisier, more experimental rock type stuff and you haven't checked this out, you definitely have to. These guys are gonna become pretty special, I think, with their subsequent records. I mean, this album is very special in and of itself, but the way they talk about music and how they want to keep going in a new direction has me very excited for what they're gonna do with the rest of their career, and I have no doubt that they will prove to be one of the most interesting and groundbreaking bands of the last couple of years. And the last thing that I pre-ordered, this is War Moon Lord, Burning Banners of the Funereal War. This is just some absolutely bitterly cold black metal. This is the limited edition of 100 on purple vinyl from Wolfspell Records. I was very excited that this got pressed, because unfortunately it was only available on Bandcamp, and due to something that happened with their system, you couldn't buy this album even on Bandcamp. So after 3 listens, you kind of just had to listen to it on YouTube or eat shit. And I was very excited that they finally got this, and I was very glad to grab the limited copy of 100. But yeah, it comes with this little insert. Sounds fantastic, you know. Just really brutal black metal, very cold, very just chilly, just great stuff here. Very excited that this got a vinyl press, and I was lucky enough to grab the limited edition version of it. Definitely one of my favorite albums of the year. The only thing I purchased on Discogs this month, this was kind of my birthday present to myself. If you guys know me, if you followed me for a long time on here, every year I buy myself something pretty rare or expensive right near my birthday, and this was that for this year. This is Standing on the Corner's Red Burns. This is just one of the best records of my generation. No exact amount of copies is known about this record, but they handed all of them themselves. Like, this back piece is just literally taped on. They handed all of these. It was an independent private press. And, you know, I've heard estimations of less than 200, which would make a lot of sense. But yeah, these resell anywhere from $100 to $400, depending. I definitely paid on the lower side of that personally. But again, you know, this was my birthday present to myself, especially since I turned a full legal adult at the age of 21. So I thought I would treat myself to something special. But if you guys are into experimental jazz, weirdo type jazz music, lots of influence of other genres, lots of melting pot ideas, a lot of spoken word, beat poetry type stuff, some hip hop elements, this record's amazing. Like I said, definitely one of my favorites. Something that I think, again, in 5, 10 years will be looked back on as something special from this era. I actually saw them open for King Krewell the year this dropped, and they played a couple songs from this, and it melted my brain out of my little skull. Sorry about that cut. The trash people went by and they were being super annoying. But the next thing, my brother was visiting for a while. He doesn't live with us, but he was visiting, and so we went to a bunch of record stores, the first one being Double Decker Records. And the first thing that I picked up at Double Decker, this is Frank Zappa and the Mothers of Invention, Dupree's Paradise. This is just a Zappa bootleg. Obviously, I'm a gigantic Zappa fan. I have pretty much everything he's ever done. And yeah, anytime I see a bootleg of an artist I like, I will pick it up. And yeah, this was recorded in 1974 at Duke University in North Carolina. So that's pretty cool. This is on the Impossible Record Works bootleg label. But yeah, you know, that's a great time for Zappa and the Mothers. This has stuff from like Lumpy Gravies on here, stuff from Apostrophe, I believe, Cosmic Debris is on here, Dupree's Paradise, Dog Breath. So yeah, it's just Zappa, you know. Love me some Zappa, and you can never really go wrong with his stuff. But yeah, this is what the labels look like over here. But yeah, you know, Zappa, not much I can really say about the man that does him any justice. He was a genuine genius of music. You know, he could arrange orchestrate. You know, he blended so many genres. He really showed that there is no rule book of music, and as long as it sounds cool and it's interesting and people like it, that's all that matters. And that blew open so many possibilities for so many artists in the future after him. So shout out to Frank Zappa for being a god. The next one I was very excited about. I've been looking for this for a couple years now. This is Molly Drake self-titled. This is Nick Drake's mother, and this is like some archival recordings of stuff that she was doing. A lot of this is like traditional, like piano-based traditional type pop music, and it's really excellent. I mean, she was just a beautiful voice and a beautiful woman, just like her son was. And these are not very easy to come across on vinyl, and when you do, they go for a pretty penny. So I actually got a pretty good deal on this one, and I was very excited about that. So yeah, this is on Squirrel Bait or Squirrel Thing Records, I believe it is. Yeah, Squirrel Thing LLC. So yeah, this is the 2013 reissue of it, and I was, like I said, very excited to find this. You rarely find these, and when you do, they're almost hitting $100 like every single time. I paid about half that, so this was a really awesome deal. And I love the liner notes on here. They talk a lot about like the recording of this kind of stuff and how she influenced Nick. They have a very similar vocal delivery and almost tonality to their voice. It's very soft-spoken, very beautiful, and yeah, I really wish she did more music, but still cool nonetheless. She gave birth to one of my all-time favorite musicians. Next up, this was another one I was very excited for. I've been looking for this one for a while. This is Arthur Verikai's self-titled, and this is the Mr. Bongo repress, which comes with this little obi strip. But yeah, Arthur Verikai, obvious Brazilian music legend. He's in that whole MPB scene where they were mixing like samba with a lot of like orchestral ideas and stuff like that. And yeah, this is an awesome reissue. This has like a gigantic book talking about the making of it. You know, there's an interview with him in here, lots of cool pictures. And yeah, not gonna pull it out all the way because it's just black vinyl. But yeah, this is just some absolutely beautiful, like psychedelic pop, a lot of orchestral ideas on here. Again, Brazilian like samba-based music. So, yeah, this is just a record I've been looking for a while, and I'm not a huge fan of the 2003 re-release of it. At least the copy I heard, it sounded pretty staticky and surface noisy. So I had been looking for a better copy of it for a long time, and yeah, I just so happened to walk into Double Decker. This was on the wall for a good price, especially compared to what it was or what it goes for online. And yeah, this was half speed mastered at Abbey Road, and this was the 2017 Mr. Bongo re-release. So very excited to find that one again. Just great stuff if you're trying to get into Brazilian music. And the last thing that I got at Double Decker, another record I've been looking for a very long time. This is a very special album, especially to my local scene, especially punk kids. This is Dead Milkmen, Big Lizard in My Backyard. This is just a really fucking funny, great punk record. This is an original on, I forget what, Enigma Records. It is an Enigma Records pressing. But yeah, this is just a really great song. I mean, if you were a kid in the Philly scene, especially like the punk scene, you know the song Bitchin' Camaro. That song has been covered way too many times to count, and it's just an absolutely fantastic album. These guys had a really great sense of humor, but also were really great musicians. And yeah, apparently these were pretty common for a while, but in recent years they become pretty hard to find. You know, not rare by any means, but you don't see them too terribly often. And again, I got a pretty good price on it, so very excited to finally own a copy of that. You guys know my love for punk music and collecting it. The next batch of stuff all came from Siren Records. These were two different trips, but I just kind of grouped them together because they're Siren, so we're going to go through these pretty quick. The first one is a 2012 reissue of the Bikini Kill self-titled EP. I don't need to tell you about Bikini Kill. Legendary band, really inspired the Riot Girl movement. You know, Ian MacKaye, in this band, legend. Don't need to say much about that man and his influence, but yeah, this is the 2012 reissue on Bikini Kill Records. Just really great, you know, punk Riot Girl type stuff. So awesome vocals on there. The next thing, this is Archgoat, the Luciferian Crown. I've been looking for some Archgoat for a little while now, and I was very stoked to stumble across this one. These guys are like a war metal, death metal type band, but they're really awesome. This album in particular is probably my favorite thing that they've done, and this released last year. So yeah, this is just a really great record. Nothing too impressive going on with the packaging, except the lyrics all come in these awesome books. There's some art in there. But yeah, really cool to finally own that. You guys know me and my metal, trying to collect more metal stuff on vinyl because I don't have enough of it for how much I enjoy the genres. Next up, definitely one of my favorite things I picked up. This is La Planète Sauvage, aka the Fantastic Planet soundtrack. One of my all-time favorite movies and one of my all-time favorite soundtracks. This is just some really sexy, kind of, you know, very outer spacey, kind of psychedelic, jazz funk type stuff. The packaging on this is awesome. I absolutely adore this movie. I watch it probably like once every month or two. It's just one of those movies I can watch all the time and never get tired of because the animation is so beautiful. The story really just rings true, and the themes of it are just kind of universally understood and appreciated things, you know. But yeah, this is just a great record. If you guys have never seen this movie, highly recommend it. It's like an hour and 20 minutes of some of the most trippy, beautifully animated, like French stuff. It's all about, it gives you an existential crisis. You know, it's about like being's place in the universe and how everything coexists. And the soundtrack is just absolutely killer. It's been sampled by like MF Doom, J Dilla. So many hip hop producers touched that back in the day. This one I was very excited about. This is Music from the Penguin Cafe by Penguin Cafe Orchestra. I never thought I would find this record in the wild, but as soon as I walked into Double Decker, it was right there in the front of the new arrival section. I meant to say Siren Records, I just realized I said Double Decker. But yeah, this is just a really amazing like chamber jazz record, chamber music type thing. This is the Editions EG repress of it from 1987, I believe. But yeah, originals of this go for stupid money, so this second pressing is absolutely fine to me. But this is just absolutely beautiful. I know people like this group, but I really don't see them brought up in like the conversation of like jazz music a lot like that, or at least not enough for how much I personally enjoy them. This record is just absolutely amazing. Great use of strings all over this. The recording on it is really intimate and pretty. And yeah, this vinyl pressing of it sounds absolutely mint. So really beautiful, really stoked to have that. And then they had this in the rare psychedelic garage section, and I had never heard this. I completely took a shot in the dark on it just because of the cover and the genre tag that it was associated with. But this is Freedom Through the Years. This was absolutely awesome stuff. Again, just cool, like, you know, harder edge, psychedelic, garagey, kind of more, I guess, on the side of like progressive in a way type stuff. But yeah, this is just absolutely fantastic. This is an original pressing on Cotillion. But yeah, you know, you guys know me. I like my garage stuff and my psych stuff. So anything that's an original and that has an interesting cover, I will take a shot on it because I just love the genre so much. And this one definitely panned out in my favor. This is just really cool. I got to give this a listen again soon. But yeah, just really cool stuff. Very excited about that. And the last thing I got at Siren, I actually had a coupon where it was 25% off all of my purchases there, so that's why I bought so much stuff there. But this is Wolves in the Throne Room 2 Hunters, one of the best black metal records of the last couple of years. Wolves in the Throne Room just kind of absolutely changed the game, or at least they epitomized the new wave of black metal with the more atmospheric black metal type stuff, the more nature-centric stuff. And again, I love the sleeves and the designs of these stuff, of this packaging. Not too much going on with the label, so I won't pull out both records. But yeah, just some absolutely gorgeous, just very haunting, melodic, kind of atmospheric black metal type stuff. One of the best bands of the last little while when it comes to metal music, in my personal opinion. And yeah, this is my favorite of theirs. They had a couple others, but this is my favorite, and I didn't have any other stuff, so I was very stoked to finally add some Wolves into my record collection. Now, the rest of these, I believe, all come from my go-to spot, which you guys have heard me talk about before. And, yeah, I mean, this place I go to regularly is just unbelievably cheap. Like, people know about this place, but if more people knew about this place, they would flock there. Like, this place is just fucking awesome. But, yeah, I'm gonna try and rifle through these real quick because there's like 30 from this place. So yeah, this was in the price reduced. This is Tim Buckley's Star Sailor. Really amazing avant-garde folk music. I mean, obviously Tim Buckley, I don't need to say much, changed the game, gave birth to Jeff Buckley, who released Grace, which is one of the greatest albums ever made. This is like a random reissue. I couldn't find an exact year on it, but this is just a random Warner reissue. It was in the price reduced, as was this. This is Happy Sad. And again, this is just a random Elektra reissue. But again, I couldn't find a specific year. I couldn't actually find the specific pressing even on Discogs. So I don't know what the deal was about that, but I was very excited because I didn't have any Tim Buckley in my collection. A couple $2 records. This is the Lawrence of Arabia soundtrack. Just really beautiful, like orchestral type stuff. This movie is an absolute stunner. This one actually doesn't even have a sleeve, but the record's in pretty good shape. And yeah, you guys know I like my movies. I love my soundtracks. So this was very cool to find for $2 in a pretty good condition. Another $2 find. This is Grateful Dead, Skull and Roses. You know, this has Bertha on it, which is one of the best Dead songs. And yeah, just absolutely great stuff. You guys know I love me some Dead, and I just didn't have this one, so I was very excited to find it. This is a Warner Bros. Pressing of it, or a Grateful Dead Records press of it. So yeah, very cool, especially for $2. I mean, it's not the best shape, but it plays through real nice, and eventually if I want to, I can upgrade that. There was a gigantic collection that came in, and he told me that I could dig through it and before it went out. And this was one of the things I pulled out of it. This is Thelonious Monk and John Coltrane, Monk and Train. This is just a compilation of some of their stuff that they had done together. I had never heard this. I had never even seen this. So I thought it was an actual album. But yeah, it's just a compilation of stuff that they did, some live performances and stuff. And this is on the Milestone label. So yeah, this is just pretty cool stuff. You know, you can't go wrong with the greatest pianist and one of the most important musicians of all time, you know. So this is pretty cool. I got that for cheap, and it's a really nice pressing of it, so that was pretty cool. Next up, this is John Cale and Terry Riley. I don't know why I always want to call him Tyler Riley. Church of Anthrax. This is just some really cool experimental stuff. You know, obviously, John Cale was not afraid to go experimental, and that was what Terry Riley was all about. And yeah, this collaboration is actually pretty interesting. I find it gets talked about a little bit under its weight. I feel like this album is absolutely amazing, and I don't see too many people talking about it. I believe this is a second pressing on Columbia Records, but yeah, just really cool stuff. You guys know me and my obsession with the Velvet Underground. Pretty much anything John Cale did solo is pretty much fucking great as well. And yeah, I just didn't have this one, and I was pretty excited to find that for a good price. This is just another album I didn't have yet that I've been wanting for a little bit. This is Anderson .Paak's Ventura, excuse me. I don't know why I just said that. But yeah, one of my favorite albums of the year. You know, it's not like a top like 10 album of the year or anything, but it's still really great stuff. This is one of his better records so far, in my personal opinion. And yeah, the packaging on this is great. The pressing on this is great. So very stoked. It comes with the lyrics all on the inner sleeve there. So yeah, just great neo-soul type stuff. The song Jet Black with Brandy is one of like the greatest songs of this year. I can't get enough of that song. The vibe of it, the recording of it is amazing. And the last song with that posthumous Nate Dogg feature is just killer. So I will pretty much buy any Anderson .Paak records that come out, and I have just been holding off on that one for a little bit. Another thing I found in the $2, this is Mike Oldfield's Tubular Bells, just really cool like experimental prog type stuff. A lot of you will know this from the Exorcist soundtrack. The title track was chopped up a bit and used in the Exorcist for that really creepy like piano motif that they use all over the movie. So yeah, just been hunting for this one for a while, and yeah, I found it for $2 in pretty decent shape, so couldn't say no to that. Next up, I was very excited to find this one. This is a great Canterbury Scene progressive rock album, and this is Caravan in the Land of Gray and Pink. Just really great stuff. You know, that whole Canterbury Scene with like Soft Machine and all that is absolutely legendary stuff. Completely changed the game. And yeah, this is actually an original on London Records. Comes on these beautiful like cobalt blue labels here. So yeah, this is a record you don't see too terribly often. Not that it's rare again by any means, but a lot of people tend to keep this one in their collections. And yeah, I got a crazy good deal on this one, so I was very excited to find it. And yeah, it's just great stuff. Very progressive, kind of psychedelic in sections, Canterbury type stuff. So yeah, this was awesome to find. Very excited to have that one. Another random one that I just grabbed, this is Lee Scratch Perry and the Upsetters, The Return of the Super Ape. Super Ape is the original one. It's probably my favorite like dub reggae record, or very much so up at the top of that list. And yeah, this is a really awesome repress. This was limited to 500 copies, and it's this tri-color Rasta vinyl over here. So this was really awesome. But yeah, just some absolutely essential dub reggae type stuff. Very experimental. Lee Scratch Perry was really pushing the game ahead with his production and what he was choosing to incorporate into his music. It was very weird and very interesting, and it really rung true to a lot of future artists. And yeah, this is just really great stuff. Again, this was limited to like 500 copies or something like that, so I was pretty excited to get that. Still looking for a copy of the original Super Ape. Next up, Genesis Nursery Crime. Can't say too much about the Peter Gabriel era of Genesis that hasn't been said. It's some of the most essential progressive rock ever made. And yeah, I just didn't have this one. This is a, I believe this was an early 80s or late 70s reissue of it on Atlantic. But yeah, just really killer progressive stuff. If I remember correctly, this was the first album where they had Phil Collins playing on it too, which he would obviously go on to take over Genesis when Peter Gabriel stopped. And then, you know, Phil Collins had his own thing and Peter Gabriel went on to have one of the best solo careers of all time. So yeah, you know, early era Genesis, you can never go wrong. Albums like this and Selling England by the Pound and Foxtrot and all that are just amazing progressive stuff. So was just really stoked to find a copy of that for super cheap. More John Cale. This is Music for a New Society. You know, like I said, pretty much anything John Cale is a good idea, and this is one of his better records in my opinion. Just some like art rocky type stuff. This is an original UK press on Z Records on those hot pink labels. So yeah, you know, I can't really say much about John Cale. He's one of my all-time favorite musicians. He was in the Velvet Underground. He really was one of the driving forces of the experimental side of the Velvet Underground, which is my preferred side of the group. And yeah, his solo career, again, is just one of those that blows my mind every single time. Next up, this one is also really good. I just kind of discovered this album pretty recently. This is Krabby Appleton self-titled. This is some like power pop, psychedelic pop, has a little bit of a garage edge to it. But yeah, this is an original pressing on Elektra Records. But yeah, it's just one of those, you know, like more hidden gems of the scene that not too many people talk about as often. But it's a really good record. And yeah, I just didn't have this one, was very excited. I love collecting my psych garage 60s pop stuff. And yeah, this is just one of those records that I find doesn't get talked about as enough as it should. So if you guys are into any of those genres, I highly recommend checking this one out. It's in pretty good shape. I got it for pretty cheap, so that was awesome. Next up, this one was really awesome. This was limited to 200 copies, and this is Possessed Seven Churches. Absolutely essential death metal. If you guys are into that genre at all, I really don't have to say anything about this band. They changed the game. This is a Combat Records pressing, and it's on this forest or dark green vinyl. It's not the easiest to see, but like I said, limited to 200 copies. A lot of this metal stuff doesn't get repressed, and when they do, it's so limited. So I was really stoked to find this. Apparently they only got one copy in at the store, and I was the lucky one. So yeah, it comes with a lyric sheet, but just absolutely essential death metal. If you guys are into thrash metal bands like Metallica and Megadeth and stuff, listen to some actual good music, because thrash is trash most of the time, but death metal's great. In my personal opinion, of course, there's thrash metal records I like too. I'm just busting stones, but yeah. This next one was really awesome. This is the Barry Lyndon soundtrack. Again, one of my all-time favorite movies. Probably my favorite Kubrick movie. If not, definitely top three. I just love how it takes its time. It's a very methodical movie. It plans every step, just like most Kubrick movies. But this one especially really, really takes its time. And yeah, I was very stoked to find this one. This is an original on Warner Brothers. But yeah, this is just some traditional, more Western-based classical type stuff. It's got some Irish tunes on here, some more UK-based classical stuff. And I actually got this for free because when I was shopping, when I was picking these up, a gigantic collection came in, and the guy that owns the store is he's an older gentleman, and obviously I worked there previously, so we're very cool, and I helped him unload it. So he actually gave me this one for free for helping him unload, so that was awesome. And he told me how much he loved this soundtrack, so we had a good conversation about that. Definitely one of the coolest things I picked up this month. This is something I've been looking for a while. Not this specific pressing necessarily, but just an early copy of this. This is a Stereo Tower of Pink Floyd's The Piper at the Gates of Dawn. If I remember right, this is like a third press from 1969, and it's actually a rarer variant with this color scheme of stripes on the label. This pressing, there was two plants that did this pressing, and the striping, the color of the stripes is different on both, and this is like the rarer one to find. So yeah, this is my favorite Pink Floyd album, pretty much easily. I absolutely adore this record. I've been looking for an older tower press for a long time, and yeah, I got this for a really good deal, and just super stoked. It sounds amazing, you know. It's just psychedelic Pink Floyd at its absolute best. And this is the one that has See Emily Play on the 10-track track list, as opposed to the one that's more circulated now, that's like 13 or 14 or whatever it is. Next up, you guys know my obsession with this album, and I was absolutely stoked to finally find an older copy of it. I've had a repress for a long time, but older copies of this tend to go for stupid money. But I found this second UK press of Nick Drake's Pink Moon. This is an absolutely beautiful record. I don't have to tell you, this is in my top five favorite albums ever made. It's just perfect singer-songwriter type stuff on those Island labels right there. But yeah, just one of those records that whenever I listen to it, I kind of have like a almost spiritual experience, because it just like hits me like on another level. One day I will own an original, even though they go for stupid money, but I will own an original. But this second UK press will most definitely suffice until then. And yeah, I got this for, again, a crazy, crazy, crazy good deal compared to what they go for. And yeah, this was very cool to find that. And speaking of Nick Drake, this was a piece I didn't have yet. This is The Time of No Reply. This was a little compilation of like unreleased stuff, or different versions of songs that they had released a while after he had passed. And this is an original copy over here. What is the record label on this? On Hannibal Records. But yeah, pretty cool. I actually didn't even know this had existed, but I went into the store, and on their, like, as Tunes from the Man Cave calls it, the holy shit wall, where the more expensive price stuff is hung up or displayed, this was chilling up there. It wasn't too expensive. It's just a really rare piece that you don't see too often. When people get these, they tend to keep them. And yeah, I was lucky enough to finally get a copy. I didn't even know it existed, and that same day I bought it, and now it's mine, and it's great stuff. So yeah, pretty much anything Nick Drake I don't have that's not like a compilation of stuff that he released already, I will buy. I was very excited to find this. You guys know my love for King Crimson. So this is McDonald and Giles. Obviously, you know, member of King Crimson involved in this, and it's just a record I've been looking for a while. Again, a lot of the Crimson stuff you don't tend to find traded in used. And yeah, this was just one I had been searching for a while. I got a really good price on it, and it's in excellent shape, and it's an original on Cotillion over here. So yeah, this is just some really awesome progressive stuff, you know. Pretty much anybody that was connected to King Crimson is an absolute legend of that field, and this is just a really great album. Unfortunately, it's not on streaming, I don't believe, but you know, it's great stuff. I was very happy to finally find it. I've been looking for it for a while, and yeah, just very stoked. Great stuff. If you're into King Crimson and haven't heard this, definitely seek it out if possible. I know it's on YouTube and stuff like that. Getting down to the last couple here. The next one I actually got for a really good deal as well, and this is Henry Cow's Western Culture. This is a part of that whole like rock in opposition movement, where it was just really fucking bizarre experimental stuff trying to push back at like rock ideologies. And yeah, it's just really cool. This is a original on Inner Zone Records over here. So yeah, you guys know I love my experimental stuff, and Henry Cow is just a really fucking great band, and this might be my favorite of theirs. So I was very stoked to find this for a very good price, and yeah, not much I can really say about it. If you're into experimental stuff, definitely give this one a go, and Yeah, I'm not too familiar with that whole like rock and opposition movement, but they're definitely one band that I know a lot of their stuff. So, yeah, I got it for a good price because the bottom is seam split, but I'm getting some of those Seems Easy strips that Tunes from the Man Cave always talks about. So, yeah, that's very exciting. These next ones I was very excited to find. I actually found three Blue Notes all on the same day for $5 a piece. They're not the best Blue Notes by any means, but anytime I can find like original pressing Blue Notes, I will buy them. This is Bobby McFerrin, Spontaneous Inventions. This is just cool, like vocal jazz type stuff. You know, Bobby McFerrin, again, he's been sampled by a ton of DJs and stuff like that. So, yeah. And again, this is an original on Blue Note. I actually don't think I own many other Blue Note pressings, definitely not originals besides these three now. At least not off the top of my head that I can remember. But yeah, very cool. Again, Blue Note, you know, that's just a label that if you're into jazz music, it's synonymous with the genre. You know, they put out some of the most essential stuff of all time. Their early pressings are some of the most immaculately recorded and mixed ever. Next, we got Stanley Jordan with Magic Touch. Again, guitar-based jazz type stuff. On the back, they actually compare this man to Jimi Hendrix, which I find quite funny. But again, you know, Blue Note, $5. Can't go wrong. It's a good album. You know, he's no Hendrix, but he's a good guitarist, and I found this to be pretty interesting. But yeah, like I had never heard this before. Again, I just saw Blue Note, $5, and I thought I would take a chance, and it's pretty cool stuff. And sorry for that cut. My camera died, but we're back. And the last of the Blue Notes that I had found that day. Again, I had never heard this. I love both of these guys, though. This is Bill Evans with John McLaughlin, the Alternative Man. You know, Bill Evans changed music forever. I can't give him enough credit. You know, obviously, he and Miles Davis created the modal jazz theory, and Bill Evans is just one hell of a pianist. So, yeah, again, original on Blue Note over here. So, this was pretty awesome to find. And again, John McLaughlin, an absolute wizard with a guitar. I mean, listen to Intermountain Flame by Mahavishnu Orchestra and tell me that man is not a top five guitarist of all time, and I will call you a liar because he is, in fact, a top five guitarist of all time, in my personal opinion. So, yeah, just absolute legend. This is great stuff. You know, it's not like the best out there, but you know, just hearing Bill Evans and John McLaughlin being two geniuses together is always fun stuff. And again, it's an original Blue Note. Getting down to the last two, this was just a random reissue I bought. This is John Coltrane's Ascension on Impulse. This is one of my favorite Coltrane records. I just didn't own it yet. You know, this whole avant-garde Coltrane thing is really amazing. You know, I love A Love Supreme and stuff like that, but I find a lot of the experimental stuff to be some of my favorite Coltrane releases. I forget what year this is, but it's a pretty recent reissue. I think it was 2017. But yeah, I just didn't have too terribly much jazz in my collection, and I've been trying to fix that over the course of the last year, slowly but surely. So yeah, can't go wrong with the legend himself. And last but certainly not least, this is a really awesome piece. And this is Brian Eno and David Burns, My Life on the Bush of Ghosts. But this is actually a promotional copy over here, which is pretty cool. So yeah, you don't see these too often in my area, let alone a promotional copy. So this is pretty cool. And again, this is an original on Sire over here. But yeah, I've talked about it numerous times, but Brian Eno is quite arguably my favorite musician of all time. Just between his solo records, Roxy Music, his collaborations with people like John Cale and David Byrne, then you get to everything he produced and changed the game with. It's just, the man was game changing in so many regards, and he pushed a lot of musical ideas that would go on to inspire so many people. And I mean, he fucking made ambient music essentially. So, like, not much I can really say. It's just, Eno, one of the most important musicians of all time, one of my favorites. He's just an absolute god. And yeah, I was very excited to find this. This is some cool, like, experimental art pop, kind of like lots of sample based type stuff going on there. So, That is everything I picked up during the last month for my birthday haul, as I will be calling it. Let me know down below, guys, what was your favorite thing I showed off in this batch? It's quite hard because there was a lot of awesome Grail type stuff in this month for me, but let me know down in the comments what your favorite thing was. And while you're down in the comments, hit that description, check out all those links, like, comment, subscribe, and don't forget to check out a video at the end of this one. And until next time, guys, have a nice day.